problems.
I was in disguise for you, now you can just watch it be my friend.
I'm curious about that. Yeah. So it's like,
we're going to get up this early. Come on.
If you only knew.
Join the dogs.
If you only knew.
Things. A lot of the guys actually make their own clothes, their own uniforms. I've been sitting in classes with them where they're sewing away.
It takes them like 30 minutes.
Men sewing, but they're very good at it. Most of this is pretty basic sewing. There's no edge stitching until you get buttonholes, which are a royal pain.
Yeah, basically back then it was just the take a shot, then you force.
And that's what he does. Real job, he's a tailor.
I really have to be
the bottom of the that's what we do all winter long. That's all fitted to you.
But I still don't think that happened.
Man would have made those for a woman. So your wife, who's going to be a gentleman, stays made and you would have been groping your wife to fit her up for
them. Sometimes they were a wooden board, literally. And they carved like hearts in it or some kind of love.
Would have been put down the front piece. It's another way of keeping you up straighter. My stays actually have split reed in them, which is pieces of lines all the way across it and at different angles. And that's all laced in. Mine have to be laced in back. That's a bit of a trick. I'm trying to get those laced up in the morning. Getting better at it. Actually pull them up over my head and get them time and place, it's done for the day. And then everything else is tied on, pinned on. He's got buttons everywhere. Yeah. Yeah, actually, I can carry quite a bit.
You have to remember something. Women, I would marry her only because she would bring a substantial dowry.
Right.
Sounds terrible, but it's the truth.
Coffee.
Oh, wow.
It's his job in the morning. Pretty much.
You're not making it for 50 people, right?
Yeah.
Over an open fire.
Yeah, we're making coffee for 50 people.
With a giant fire.
We could actually fire the musket. We've been to several different events. My grandmother did teach me how to sew. So took a couple classes, got a couple patterns, started making some things, discovered in the early time of the year, like now, you need a few more layers. Natural fibers typically will burn and might smolder a little bit, so contrary to what you've been reading, that everybody went up to play, and then you can see the
colds.
Yeah, you were in my room. Things would have planned. Typically, we're into smolders.
Oh my gosh, what happened? Wow.
The bells are still ringing, so.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is John Archibald, a member of the Lexington Minutemen. The company meets this morning has Captain Commanding Charles Bronson. On behalf of the Lexington Minutemen and all the people in Lexington, it's a pleasure to welcome you here. This morning we see a reenactment of the Battle of Lexington. 240 years ago, on the dawn of the 19th of April, in the year 1775, this very common became the birthplace of American liberty. Here, in this very place, lights, the first four doors to the British crown occurred. Here, on a bloody spring dawn, is born the idea of revolution and freedom. Again, we have the privilege of reliving that history that is such a significant part of our heritage. And now, Captain Parsons. Good morning. Thank you for being with us on this chilly Monday morning. We would like to dedicate the reenactment this year to two very special people who passed away very recently. Miss Elsa Sullivan dedicated her talent as a musician, author, and local historian for close to 60 years in the town of Lexington. She will be sadly missed. Particularly at Monroe Tavern, where she volunteered for many years, telling and retelling the events of April 19, 1775, to all those who came to visit. Mr. Harry Philip Edwards was a member of the Lexington Minutemen for 40 years, serving as the company's judge advocate. For most of those years, you would see Harry right out here on the green, everyone else awaiting the arrival of the British regulars. Both Harry and the Sullivan will be missed here, but their lives have touched us. They have served history, and we are all richer for having known them. What you are about to see this morning is a reenactment of the opening shots of the American Revolution as it happened. Right on the very spot where you are standing, Lexington Common. Consider some of the events which led up to this armed confrontation. In the years leading up to the battle, the British Parliament imposed various taxes on the colonies, and tension between them and the mother country grew steadily. Because of this, George III found it necessary to keep military forces in Boston to contain colonists' resentment to support the royal governor. In December of 1773, the Lexington Militia, which were training bands as it was known, under the command of Captain John Parker, reaffirmed their resolve to fight for liberty at any cost by taking the pledge. We trust in God that the state of our affairs require it. We shall be ready to sacrifice our estates and everything there in life, yea, and life itself, in support of the common cause. By 1774, virtually every town within 50 miles of Boston had formed either a militia or a minute company. A few of those towns had become storage depots for guns, powder, and military supplies. The town of Concord was one of these places. On the night of the 18th of April, Paul Revere set out from Boston on horseback to alert the local militia captains of the impending march of the British regulars. John Hancock and Samuel Adams were staying at the home of the Reverend Jonas Clark, just a short distance north of this common. It was very likely the regulars were coming to arrest these two patriots. All along his route, Revere cried his now famous alarm, alerting militia members that the British regulars were indeed on the march. Upon Revere's arrival at Lexington about midnight, militia captain John Parker ordered the ringing of the alarm bell in the old belfry to notify the townspeople and the militia of the impending crisis. Armed villagers assembled on this very town common as they appeared from their homes throughout the town. Revere, seated on horseback, could not be matched by hundreds of British regulars slowly plodding through the night as they marched towards Lexington from Boston. After much delay, some of the militia who had answered the alarm were allowed to retire. Some who lived nearby returned home. Others remained on the green, and still others rested at Buckner Tavern, which, as you can see, still stands across from the common. Throughout the night, Parker sent scouts on horseback towards Boston to watch for the movement of regulars and to notify him of their approach. It was near daybreak when
when Thaddeus Bowman, a poor captain of the Scotia, returned to Buckman Tavern and reported excitedly to Captain Parker that the Regulus were indeed less than 1/2 mile away. As the reenactment begins, this is the scene. Some militiamen are on the common, and others are at Buckman Tavern. Inside the tavern, Captain Parker is anxiously awaiting for any report, anything at all, regarding the movement of the column of the British regulars. You will see Thaddeus Bowman arrive on horseback and alert Captain Parker of the news. The captain will order the firing of the alarm guns, and then will order 16-year-old William Diamond to continue the alarm on his drum. The militia will rally to the town's defense and take up their positions on the common. After alerting Hancock and Adams at midnight, Paul Revere spied a patrol of British officers on horseback heading towards the town of Lincoln. Unfortunately, Mr. Revere was captured a short time later. But he was soon released and then walked back to Lexington, where John Hancock and Samuel Adams were preparing to evacuate to the town of Warren. Suddenly, Hancock remembered a trunk full of his private papers had been left behind at Buckman Tavern. The information on these papers could put many lives in danger. What could be incriminating information? Realizing the gravity of the situation, Revere volunteered to retrieve this trunk. As the redcoats advance on the common, you will see British officers demand that the rebels disperse and return to their homes. After some hesitation, several of the militia will push to the front in defiance of the order. Others will retreat and begin to run. Captain Parker will steady his men and exhort them to courage. Many will be confused. Many will be angry. All will be scared and unsure of their actions. In an attempt to pacify the rebellious farmers, the British regulars will release two militiamen from Auburn who were captured earlier as they were caught spying on the British advance. It is at this time that Captain Parker will issue the command to his men, let the troops pass by, do not fire without they begin first. Incidentally, you can find a 19th century interpretation of this quote etched in stone on the northwest corner of the common. Suddenly, a shot will ring out. To this day, we don't know exactly who fired first. The first armed confrontation of the American Revolution will have begun.
What's that, Daddy? dead people. Because there's one.
Somebody comes over.
She's got speed coils.
She's
not really.
All the wives come back out and try to find out.
Is it near that building or that building?
Voluntary coagulation of people.
You make a very simple mistake, which you can avoid.